Hi there. Are you Alex, my new student? Okay, great. You're right on time for your first tutoring session. Go ahead, take a seat. So you're taking a preliminary coding class. In your tutoring sessions with me, we'll be going over some of your lecture material that you learn in class, as well as some other supplementary material. So, how was your first class? Okay. So you learned. Oh, okay. Yeah. So you learned some basics about C++. Great. Yeah, that's definitely something we can take a look at. It'll definitely be helpful if we review that. Let me take a look. Great. So let's get started. If you look at my screen here, this is what a very basic C++ program looks like. You've probably saw something similar to this during your class. There's a few components to this that I think is some very fundamental information you should know. At the top here in line one, you'll see a hashtag include and then in brackets IOSTREAM. Commands like these are ways to access external libraries and interfaces so that your program can use them without having to define those functions or interfaces on its own. In the next line here, you'll see using namespace std. This is essentially a line that simplifies the rest of our coding. The built-in C++ libraries that we frequently use are all kept in the standard namespace. So typically, when you use functions or classes from those libraries, you must append the prefix std colon colon in front of everything you use that's from one of these libraries. To really simplify that and make things easier on yourself, if you have using namespace std, you can omit every one of those prefixes going onwards, which is honestly really convenient. Past this syntax at the top, you'll usually have a function called main. That's what you see right here. This is essentially a function whose name is main. You can think of it like your main driver function that does a lot of what your program does. It's in charge of running a majority of your program. Int main will return an integer, which is why you see the type int in front of it. And because this function returns an integer, at the end you have this line return 0. So 0 is just traditionally the integer you return. If everything goes normally, if everything runs smoothly, once it returns zero, the function ends and your program ends. And then you'll see here in comments, these two angle slashes indicate that everything in this line 6 are comments, so not real code, and it won't actually affect your program in any way. So you can just write intuitive comments for your own sake. So you can type your code in int main, etc. So let's do something simple. Let's declare a variable. There are many types. You can think of variable types pretty straightforwardly. For example, a number is a number. In programming, we'll usually define numbers as either integers, which are whole numbers, or maybe doubles, or floats, which are decimal numbers. For simplicity's sake, let's start off with a integer variable, and let's name it x. Now we can create as many as we need to. Let's create a y integer. There are other variable types as well. For example, in real life, you have words, you have letters, and those all represent different things. So likewise, in programming, you can have a string variable. You can have a character variable. In this case, the character type represents any letter or written character. So now that we have these variables defined, we can do things with them. All sorts of things. If we start off really basic, we can do something like assign the number 1 to x. So now, if we ever reference the variable x, it will be interpreted as holding the number 1, or the integer 1, because we gave it type integer. We can likewise give assign 2 to integer y. And now we can do calculations with them, all sorts of mathematical calculations that you would do in real life. X plus y, or x minus y, or x divided by y, or x plus y times y plus y. So I didn't put any parentheses in this line, but the program will interpret this using the order of operations. So it will do the multiplication first, and then do addition from left to right. So we've done all of these calculations. Something really simple we can do is sort of have the program talk to us, if that makes sense. That's sort of like a very intuitive way of thinking. To be more exact, what you can have the program do is to print as it's running. So when you run the program, it can actually create output, print letters, numbers, words, whatever you tell it to footprint. So now that we've done sort of these calculations, we can actually do this. See out x plus y. See out x minus y. See out x divided by y. And see out x plus y times y plus y. So now in the past, instead of just doing these calculations and nothing else, now the program will do these calculations and then print it out for us to see. This is really nice because it can really help you visualize what your program is doing. And of course, it's pretty likely that you'll have a program where you want the functionality to involve printing out data or results or some kind of information. So this is really useful for that. So if we try running this, here we go. As you can see, right here is our output. So first it printed 3. X plus y, 1 plus 2 is 3. And if you check the rest, you'll see that it is correct. Some things I want to go over is actually this third command. You'll see that the result is 0, which at first you're maybe like, hold on, 1 divided by 2 is not 0. One little tricky point here is that, remember, x and y are integers. That means they're whole numbers. They physically cannot have a decimal. So likewise, when the program is doing calculations with integers, it will refuse any output that contains a decimal because the input variables were integers. So it will naturally and automatically change your output into an integer. And how it does that is it cuts off any digits, any numbers after the decimal point, and just keeps the whole numbers before the decimal point. So if you go back here, 1 divided by 2 is 0.5 or 1/2. So if you delete everything after the decimal, in other words, the 5 after the decimal, all you'll be left with is the 0 in 0.5. Hence why the output is 0. And lastly, if we look at the last command we went over, y times y, 2 times 2 is 4, plus 1 is 5, plus 2 is 7, which again matches with our output. So we can be confident that our program so far is doing what it's supposed to do. It's producing the correct calculations without any bugs. Let's get rid of this code and let's do something that's a very common program. It's called Hello World. You might have done this in class, but let's take a look. So we already declared a string a variable on line 12. Let's declare another string called string b. And then let's declare another variable called string c. Right now, these strings are undefined, so they don't necessarily correspond to any actual information because we haven't given it anything to hold on to. But we can do that now by, let's set a equal to a string. And just as a reminder, a string is any set of written characters. So you can think of them as words, but they don't need to be intelligible words. They can be any random collection of characters. They can also be numeric characters. They can make absolutely no sense, just a random sequence of letters. But in this case, let's make them words. So let's set A to hello. We can set B to actually a space and nothing else. So it's just the space between these quotation marks. The only thing I typed was a space. That's kind of cool, right? And let's set C equal to world exclamation mark. Now, the program has variables that separately say hello, space, and world. So now we can, you know, print that out. The program can say to us, hello world. We can do that a variety of ways. We can see out them on separate lines like we did before. The end L here is one method of telling the program to print on the next line. It essentially stands for end line or end L. And then we can just see out all of them individually. Oops, C. And then if we try running this, hello world. Because we did this, you'll see the second line is actually just the space because we see outed B, which is just the space. That looks kind of funny. So we could omit B and not print it at all. But what if we want hello world on one line altogether, not on separate lines? Then we could do this. See out A. Then B. Then C. Which should give us hello and then space. And then world. If we run that, let's see what we get. Nice, so we get this hello world. Another way we can do this is to see out all of them concatenated together. So string concatenation essentially means you add one string to the end of another, like so, A plus B plus C. This adds B to the end of A and then C to the end of B. which combines or concatenates A with B with C. This likewise will give us Hello World, the third one that we made. Great. So we've seen that we can do all sorts of stuff with variables, and we can also see what the program is doing by asking it to print out information for us. One small problem you might have realized by now is that things get very tedious. If we want to do a lot of things and we're manually doing them, for example, if we want to count down from 100, we could do this, see out 99. Oh, if we're counting down from 100, we probably want to start from 100. So we could do this, see out every number, write a line of code for every number, and you'll see that it is indeed counting down, printing what we told it to print, 100, then 99. But are we really going to type every number out? That seems very tedious and not efficient. The point of having a program, of writing a program, is to make the process more efficient. So we definitely don't want to be doing something that's so counterintuitive. And that leads us to our second topic. You'll probably be learning this in your next lecture, but we can get a quick tutorial on it now so you're extra prepared for class tomorrow. So the solution to doing a set of reoccurring tasks with a minimal amount of code, so essentially not having to write out everything, the solution is to use loops. Loops are pre-designed syntax that will repeat a set of actions over and over until the loop has finished. What this means is instead of you, the human, writing out the command 100, 1,000 times, you just have to write the command once, but tell the program to run that one command 100, 1,000 times, which will save you a lot of time. So it's definitely easier if I show you first. So going back to the countdown example, let's take a look at this. So right here, this two lines of code produces a loop that does exactly what all of our C out lines did before. Instead of needing 100 C out statements to count down from 100, all you need now is these two lines to do the exact same thing. So let's try running this and see what we get. Alright, so you'll see the output starting from 100 all the way down to 0. Perfect. So just breaking down what these lines are doing. This is a type of loop called a for loop. The program repeats what is inside this for loop, what is inside the opening and the closing brackets, until you tell it to stop. How do you tell it to stop? Well, this middle part in between the first semicolon and the second semicolon, this is the continuing condition. So while the variable I is still greater than or equal to 0, the program knows to continue repeating the for loop. This first section of the for loop is the initialization of the variable I, which we continue to use in the rest of the loop. So we declare I as an integer, set it equal to 100. This third and final piece of the for loop, I minus minus, is a shorthand for this. I equals I minus 1. Because it's a shorthand, the program recognizes it as I equals I minus 1. What does that mean? That means after every iteration of the loop, the program will then run this calculation. I equals I minus 1. This will decrease I by 1 every single time the loop runs. So you can imagine I starts off at being 100, then you subtract 1, and now it's 99. Then you subtract 1 again, and now it's 98. And the loop will continue repeating itself and subtracting until we hit the condition we talked about earlier. I is greater than or equal to 0. Once it hits this condition and it's no longer true, the loop will finally end. In other words, when I becomes less than 0 or negative 1, the loop will end. So what is it doing every time it repeats? It's doing this line right here, line 17. See out I. That's how we get these print statements. Every time the loop repeats, it's printing out the new updated value of I. And remember, I is decrementing over and over again. From 100, that gets printed, to 99. That gets printed to 98, that gets printed to 97, so on and so forth. That's why loops are super cool. There are several other types of loops, but let's stop here for today. Our time is almost up. Do you have any questions for me? I hope everything was helpful and intuitive. I know coding can be kind of confusing at times. Okay. I'm glad to hear there's no questions. Wow, that sounds great. You're definitely on top of this material so far. I'm really proud of you. Yes, you'll definitely be seeing this in your next lecture tomorrow. They'll definitely be introducing for loops and also other kinds of loops. I definitely think you're well prepared. All right, great. I think this was a great first tutoring session. All right, have a good day, Alex. Bye.